Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Promote Science. So as you know, Promote Science is about our initiative to spread science education and information about career opportunities in the society, and especially among school children. So today we have a very special guest. We have Professor Dipankar Banerjee from Indian Institute of Astrophysics, Bangalore. Professor Banerjee came to IISER Kolkata to deliver a colloquium on the title, Codaikanal, Digitized Data Archive and Long-Term Study of the Sun. So welcome, Professor Banerjee. It is very nice to have you on Promote Science. So the first question is like, how would you explain about your research to a layman?
Okay. So first of all, thank you very much for inviting me for this short chat. Okay, so I work in Indian astrophysics, and my subject area is to look at the sun. And as you know, the sun is our source of life. So what is really happening in the sun in terms, the sun provides all the energy to us. Our existence is because of the presence of the sun. So it's important to understand that, the sun, it's a star. It is one of our nearest stars. But how this star is going to behave tomorrow, say, for example. So if you want to understand that, you have to also know how the sun was behaving yesterday, right? So that way, to have this information over, say, 100 years, as you just mentioned, I am also working with this 100 years of data about sun. So from our observatory, last 100 years, observers have looked at the sun and taken some scientific observations. And from that, we are trying to understand, how sun was behaving for the last 100 years. Once we understand that, sun actually do have some changes happening in the atmosphere particularly, and how much percentage of change will impact our climate and our, energy, what you get from the sun and so on, is one of the subject matter. So it is important to sort of study sun as a star, because it's our nearest star. Yeah. And that gives also a lot of information in terms of all the other stars or the other astronomical objects, how they behave and so on, because sun is the closest star. Yeah. So the kind of details what we can see from the sun is not possible for other astrophysical objects, because they are all studied as a point object in the sky, whereas sun is much more extended object. There is actually another very important reason why we study sun, because sun is a astrophysical laboratory. Like many branches of physics, what we try to study or verify in the laboratory, yeah, has certain limitations. Yeah. Like you can achieve certain temperature, you can achieve certain density and pressure and so on in a laboratory environment. Even a subject called plasma physics. Basically, any state of matter, if you go on hitting an object, it changes one state to another, and eventually it becomes a combination of charge, particles. So it's a mixture of neutrals and ions and so on. So that state is called plasma state. So the plasma physics laboratories also can achieve certain conditions in the laboratory. Again, very high temperature, strong magnetic fields. Even you have a hard, probably a tokamak. These are plasma confinements and so on. Mm-hmm. So those conditions are very limited. Whereas in the case of sun, it's a natural source where you have possibilities of verifying some of these theories of plasma physics. So that provides you an ideal laboratory. I mean, I can go on for for half an hour why you should study sun, yeah, but please go ahead and ask me the next question. Yeah.
So, like, going back into history, like when you were studying in school or in college, so what motivated you to get into science or in astronomy in particular?
Okay. So first thing is, of course, I was interested or fascinated to study science, not astronomy at that point of time. Yeah. Actually, there is a little bit of background to it also, because I'm actually born and brought up in Calcutta, yeah, and you don't see the sky in Calcutta as much. So I never had actually any fascination about doing astronomy, frankly. So I studied physics up to my MSc. I had actually condensed matter physics as my specialization. But I went to Bangalore for doing PhD and all that. I found out that astrophysics is another, you know, sort of application area of fundamental physics only. It is not a different branch. It is one, you know, branch of physics only. So that way astronomy, a lot of people are fascinated by astronomy from childhood, but in my case it didn't happen. But science is something, you know, it's again, whatever you see in everyday life, you want to know why this thing happens this way, not some other way. And science can only explain you that. So if you have an inquisitive mind, I think you always get fascinated about science. So that's, I think, the primary reason why I was also fascinated in science.
Yeah, very interesting. So now if we go to school children who are just finishing their 10th grade or 12th grade, especially students from rural India, so can you let us know about what are the career opportunities in science, and especially in the field of astronomy and astrophysics, which they can pursue?
Yeah, very good point. Because, you know, astronomy and astrophysics as a subject is still not available in sort of undergraduate level in most of the universities across India. You see, astronomy and astrophysics is also developing very rapidly. So that way, it could be useful to have astronomy and astrophysics as a subject area, but it's not really so crucial as well. If you study physics, you will be able to study astronomy in a later career. I think the opportunities are quite good at this point of time because of this advent of new ISARs in different parts of India. Even IITs are taking students at undergraduate level for basic sciences, because originally IITs were aimed for only engineering studies. As compared to our times, I would say, I mean, again, giving the reference of Calcutta, there are limited colleges only you can study physics, and then going to MSc even was more restrictive because we had only something around 60 seats in science college for MSc. So many students who were quite good, I would say, couldn't get into, you know, the master's level even with the physics honors. So those days were, even I would say, was tougher in terms of opportunities. But now things are much, much better. There are many more colleges who have been given master's affiliations. There are across. So basically for science, I know you need motivated students. You have to feel excited about it, then only you will enjoy it. It's about a enjoyment. It's just not, you know, a 9-to-5 job. So it's a different world.
It matters.
Yeah, I mean, if you feel excited about it, then, I mean, till today, you know, I mean, we work 365 days a year. Nobody asks us to work like that. But we don't think it is a work. I mean, it is just, you know, you feel excited and you explore further. So part of the exploration is your regular activities, which is assigned to you as a faculty. But this exploration of science is beyond, you know, regular routine, you know, work. So I think that excitement, that interest, if you can generate early enough in your career, then the rest is taken care of.
So one more question, continuation into this fact. So what kind of opportunities are available in Indian Institute of Astrophysics for school students or for maybe undergraduate students?
Okay, good point. You see, one difficulty with institutes like us, because originally these institutes were sort of conceptualized as a basic premier research institutes. We were not fundamentally involved in teaching, particularly undergraduate or postgraduate students. So the infrastructure and the overall setup is such that we are limited to be able to accommodate more students on short-term visits and all that. So what we have done is, over the years, is we have now intern programs, whereby students from undergraduate level also can come and spend a few weeks to months during their holiday periods and so on and so forth. So there is a through online portal through which you can apply. Every 3 months the portal opens up, and then students can apply into that, and the students are selected going through other, other recommendations and things like that. But I must admit that there are not too much opportunities for undergraduate, more opportunities for postgraduate students for a long sort of few weeks kind of interaction with the faculties and doing something, you know, more substantial. We do have outreach programs. Time to time, there are public, lectures. There are also science days, whereby anybody can walk in. We have some exhibitions and so on. Some displays how telescope works and some setup about how to look at the sun, spectrographs, how the spectrograph works. So these are there on open days, and there are also some schools and some institutions also visit us in a more organized way, I would say. So if you write to our institute and then say that I want to visit with 50 students, that can be organized. So there are also JBNSTA students, they visit every year to our institute. I also come and sometimes give lecture to JBNSTA.
Yeah. Yeah, so another question is continuing into this scientific career, like many students, they want to know like what happens after doing a PhD. Yeah, so there is a kind of vague understanding like what happens after doing a PhD.
Okay, this is also a good point because in earlier days probably even if you go for take teaching as a profession, people used to probably finish their masters and get into teaching. But now with more exposures and all that, PhD is also becoming a sort of prerequisite, even if you want to go for teaching, particularly in higher level teaching at university and college teaching. So it's a good idea to do it. It's like you're expanding your explorations further, because research, first time it gives you an opportunity to think what is already not written up,
yeah.
Right? So your innovative skills, your imagination skills, are tested during a PhD period. But then during the PhD period, also you can sort of make an assessment that how much you are enjoying that. And based on that, and one can assess, that this particular way of, looking at the science, whether you can take it as a career. Of course, if you even choose to take that as a career, things are competitive these days. So. Not natural thing is that after PhD you do a postdoctoral kind of period, and that's the time when you can actually also assess how much independently you can work on. Because PhD period you are still associated with the guide, and sometimes the guide imposes his or her ideas on you. Always it doesn't happen because modern day we are changing. I mean, I like my students to have their own ideas and at least make some progress with their own ideas at the final years of their PhDs. But postdoc period is a period where you could explore on your own, and that gives you further confidence that this can be taken as a career and so on. So even after PhD, one can go to teaching, and one should go to teaching. Because everybody may not be able to be accommodated in research as a full-time career. This is again another very important element that people have a misconception, particularly in India, that you are going to teaching means your research is all gone. In majority of the advanced developed countries, teaching and research goes hand in hand. And if that doesn't happen, then actually your teaching level will also not improve. So I think again, ISAT is a very good example. So that's a model which now India have realized to be followed. So it's a combination of teaching and research, and some people will probably sort of enjoy the teaching more than the research part. So they can keep a balance in their career as they progress. But PhD is again a first step, I think. To decide whether what you want to do next in academia.
So one curiosity which I have is like, where do you see India in the field of astronomy and astrophysics on timescales of say like a decade or so?
Actually, it's very promising at this point of time. I almost can't believe the number of projects some of us are handling. This has all come in the last few years. I mean, when I came or sort of returned back in India about 13 years back, that time, whatever opportunities were there in India in terms of astronomy, astrophysics, major project. I mean, you see, the fundamental science, some theoretical work, you can sit anywhere in the world and do on your own.
Yeah.
But for advancement, sometimes you also need, particularly for astronomy, astrophysics, you need bigger facilities. You need telescopes from ground, from space, and so on. So now, at this point of time, India is participating in mega, you know, international projects. India is partnered to TMT, which is a 30-meter telescope project, which is probably going to be, it was expected to be in Hawaii, but now they are shifting the location to probably Canary Islands. India is partnered to LIGO with the gravitational project, again, new discoveries, and, you know, partnered to that, neutrino observatories. I am in the solar physics. We are, you know, building a, you know, several payloads for a space mission. We are going to a Lagrangian 1 point. You know, only the U.S. have been able to reach the Lagrangian 1 point, and we are going to put up a observatory at Lagrangian 1 point, looking at the sun 24 hours, 365 days a year. We are also trying to build a 2 meter class solar telescope in the Himalayas. The biggest solar telescope in the world at this point is 1.6 meter. This is the primary mirror size, which essentially dictates, you know, how many photons you can collect. So that will give you the best, you know, possibilities of looking at the sun with highest possible resolution and so on. So we are actually thinking big. So I think being in India, I feel I'm actually more fortunate than anybody else in the rest of the world, because we are getting these opportunities suddenly, big way. I mean, it's a big step jump. You know, 20 years back, we didn't have anything for observational facilities from India. And suddenly, we are going to get many things, you know, in 10 years or so. So, since you asked about decades time from now, we, in terms of facilities and you know, possibilities, we will be at par in any international standard, if not better than. I mean, to be frank, you know, if you are in the developed world, your proposal is you know, evaluated you know, much more rigorously, and your success rate of a proposal is much less than what it is today in India. We can get scientific funding probably much easily.
I would like to go on and on. Like, we are having a very interesting discussion, but I would like to conclude with the final question. So, sir, like, what message would you give to the younger generation, especially those studying in schools, colleges, and in rural India?
Yeah. So, I think it's a very important point. I think globally within India, there are a lot of initiatives now to reach out to people at because. I think the main strength lies in our villages.
Yeah.
And frankly speaking, what is happening is now we are seeing already the change. The best students we are getting from you know, smaller towns and so on, rather than the main you know, so-called metro cities.
Yeah.
So because there are many more motivated people amongst the rural India, they feel still excited about science. Once they get the exposure, once they get the, you know, facilities, they are more dedicated towards science. That's our current experience already now. Because in, you know, in the big cities, people have too much diversions. And they have more options. I mean, you see, all professions are good. It's not that academia is something, you know, is only should be taken up. All professions have their, all subject areas has its own beauty, social sciences, history, I mean, everything need to be studied at its own depth. But to feel excited about science is something which has to be there almost in your blood as you grow. So if that happens, you know, it's a really, and we have so much of potential in the, you know, across the country. So we have to tap, you know, all the resources available across the country. So if you leave out, you know, the rural India, you are actually missing out a major chunk. Mm-hmm. So now, I think because of all the placements of these institutes and universities, even rural colleges, I love to go to, you know, a small little town and give public talks and so on. I try my best. And we see very, very bright young personalities there. So the message would be that the the future is very bright as far as India is concerned in terms of astronomy, astrophysics, I can say. Major facilities are coming, major exposures are also happening through these different organizations. So if you guys can also reach out people, bring them in into the system, because they need to be exposed to what is available. Often that was not visible outside, and of course internet has made a big change in this. So anybody can access internet from anywhere in the country, and they know much more than sometimes we know about certain things. So just reach out to people.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable time. And I would also like to thank Center of Excellence in Space Science in India and ISRO Kolkata for hosting Professor Banerjee. Thank you, sir, for your time. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.